Good afternoon and welcome to Bobcat Update. I'm Megan Holzman. We have an update on the deadly church shooting south of San Antonio.
And a family is recovering after being caught up in a high-speed chase. I'm Scott Stutzman. Thanks for joining us. A San Marcos man accused of stalking started a high-speed chase Monday that resulted in a woman and three children being injured in a crash. Police say a woman called to accuse McLean William Traynor of stalking her daughter at her place of work. When the police approached his vehicle, Traynor took off and did not stop until he collided with two other vehicles. Traynor was critically injured in the crash. According to the San Marcos Police Department, he faces charges of stalking and aggravated assault with a deadly weapon.
Police have discovered that the man who killed 26 people at Sutherland Springs Church was arrested 3 years ago on an animal cruelty charge. Police confirm that Devin Kelly had a violent past, including several instances of domestic abuse and assault. A vigil was held yesterday to honor the victims of the mass shooting. Vice President Pence, Senator Cruz, and Governor Abbott were among those attending the service. Pence described the massacre as evil descending on a small town. Sutherland Springs has a population of about 630 people. The pastor of the church in Sutherland Springs plans to demolish the building where last week's weekend's massacre took place. The pastor, who lost his daughter in the shooting, says that going back to the church for service would be too painful. Thoughts of replacing the church with a prayer garden have been brought up, but the pastor says that the church members have not had a chance to make a final decision.
The Texas State's Office of International Affairs is dedicated to familiarizing international students with the Bobcat lifestyle. Preston Winsett has more.
The International Affairs Office is celebrating International Education Month by hosting a series of events for students. The events provide a way for international students to engage in the Texas State culture and tradition. Upcoming events include a celebration luncheon to welcome students.
November 10th, we have our International Celebration Lunch, and so that is a big Thanksgiving lunch for all of our internationally minded folks at Texas State. So that can be both international students, faculty, and staff, and domestic faculty, students, and staff. It's open to all.
The Thornton House on Wood Street is where the International Affairs Office is located, along with the Study Abroad Office. The International Office helps students from other countries who are here to live and study.
So as a new incoming international student to Texas State University, they have to actually go through our office in order to get the documentation for them to get a visa appointment, to get a visa to come to the U.S.
The International Office has a wide range of responsibilities, including the distribution of more than $420,000 in scholarships each year.
Each fall semester, we welcome between about 170 and 180 new students.
Studying at Texas State now are 560 international students from 80 different countries.
For more information, you can contact International Affairs at intlaffairs@texasstate.edu or visit the Thornton International House on the corner of Woods and North Street. For Bobcat Update, I'm Preston Winsett.
Thousands of visitors are making their way to New Braunfels this week for the annual Worst Fest celebration. The 10-day festival is underway at Landa Park. Visitors from around the world celebrate German culture and have a good time. The festival is for all ages and offers a daily lineup of live music, carnival rides, and souvenir shops. There's also a lot of food and drink, including a wide variety of sausages. Worst Fest ends Sunday.
Students and faculty members celebrated Diwali over the weekend at Texas State. The Diwali Festival of Lights represents the triumph of good over evil and light over darkness. On Saturday, the Texas State Indian Student Association shared the holiday with people from all walks of life. The Diwali celebration is an opportunity to connect the Indian culture with other communities at Texas State.
Alcac Library's Write-In Wednesdays provides a space for student writers to test their creative abilities while working under a deadline. Bobcat Update's Taylor Kalmerton has the story.
30 days to assemble 50,000 words into one novel. That's the goal of National Novel Writing Month, or NaNoWriMo. Emily Segoria, now a library assistant in Alcac, remembers completing her novel in the 30-day time frame when she was a student.
There were a lot of late nights, lots of caffeine, and definitely a fair amount of chocolate involved, but it was worth it.
Segoria will participate as a mentor for Write-In Wednesdays. The free event is held in Alcac's Open Theater from 6 to 9 p.m. every Wednesday until the end of November. Student writers often work in solitude for extended periods of time, and this event offers them a chance to share ideas and socialize.
A lot of times when you're writing, you're by yourself, you're in your room or in your house or whatever, and this way you can interact with other people.
If you'd still like to be a part of this month-long event, it's not too late for you to sign up. Head to the Texas State Events calendar for more information. For Bobcat Update, I'm Taylor Camerton.
Coming up, a new playground in San Marcos will have some unique features.
And we have a profile on the new music curator at the Willif Collections. We'll be right back.
County Food Bank has been a valuable asset to our community by holding food distributions for citizens in need.
We at Hayes County Food Bank are passionately committed to improving lives by rescuing food from local community partners, redistributing that food to those who need it, and also providing nutrition education to make up a healthier future to our clients.
Monday through Thursday, Food Bank volunteers fill the trucks with food to serve citizens in multiple areas like San Marcos, Kyle, and Martindale. And they're working day by day to extend even further than Hayes County. Wondering how you can give back and make a difference? You can start by directly donating food, or you can volunteer.
So anyone that's interested in donating food, we take any food item basically. We love non-perishables. They can just come in anytime when our office is open, from 8 to 4 Monday through Thursday and 8 to 12 on Friday.
For more information on how to get involved, go online to HayesFoodBank.org. Together we can eliminate hunger, one county at a time.
Buta residents voted this week against putting fluoride back into their water supply. The city hasn't used fluoride since 2015, which is the same year San Marcos voted to remove the additive from its water. Fluoridation as a public service has existed in American communities for over 70 years. The Federal Centers for Disease Control credits fluoride for reducing tooth decay nationwide throughout the 20th century. However, organizations like Buta Citizens for Safe Water oppose the additive, and more than two-thirds of those who voted in the city's election Tuesday agreed.
A volcano, a mermaid castle, and a pirate ship. These are some of the features that San Marcos children will encounter at a new playground that's in the works. Bobcat Update's Jackie Lang tells us about the plans.
It will be a big playground, occupying more than 22,000 square feet. Toddlers will have their own section, and there will be one for kids 5 to 12 years old. Designers have safety and inclusiveness in mind. The playground will have rubber flooring and disability swings, and the area will have a fence surrounding it.
Well, I think we've done a real good job of listening to the public and trying to address most of the concerns and ideas that the public has presented to us.
City officials had a chance to check out the design at a meeting last week. They discussed adding more seats for adults and perhaps adding a small stage for music. The park will be unique to San Marcos.
There is magic in the wooden playground that I remember growing up and that my son feels when he plays in it now. And I feel like that's so important because this town is so special.
Park designers want children to have a sense of adventure while at the playground. Ocarina Springs will serve as a theme. Handprints in the cemented trail around the playground will go untouched to preserve part of the original playground, which is located off of CM Allen Parkway. Construction is scheduled to begin in February and will take a total of 6 to 8 weeks, depending on the weather. For Bobcat Update, I'm Jackie Lang.
Austin Mayor Steve Adler will not participate in the Veterans Day Parade in Austin this weekend. Adler says he will sit it out because of a group that plans to march in the parade with a Confederate flag. Parade organizers are allowing the organization Descendants of Confederate Veterans to not only march, but also display the secessionist flag. Adler says the flag is a symbol of racism and white supremacy and should not be applauded at parades. Instead of marching, Adler plans to volunteer at the Central Texas Food Bank.
Many men are participating in No Shave November. You'll know who if you take notice of their facial hair. The idea is to raise awareness about cancer and to encourage donations to fight it. Another name for it all is Movember. Money raised by fraternities who get involved goes to fight prostate and testicular cancer. Beards and mustaches may be a temporary addition to their facial features. Movember wraps up at the end of the month. The Whitliff Collections has a new music curator. Bobcat Update's Matthew Harrington tells us more.
This is San Antonio native Hector Saldana, music curator for the Whitliff Collections. I sat down with Saldana earlier to ask him what influences he's bringing to Texas State.
Well, I don't know if I'm bringing the San Antonio sound here. I think I'm bringing the love and appreciation for it here. You know, around the time I was 10 or 11, I knew I wanted to learn the guitar. My brother and I were real in tune to the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and Sir Douglas Quintet. So, you know, we got the bug. He's the drummer in my group.
Make me cry, sing me a song, like gonna write for.
We're the Crayolas with a K. The guys in the band went ugh when I said we were going to be called the Crayolas, but the K, like the Kinks, kind of made it okay, and then the name kind of stuck.
Saldana isn't only the front man for the Crayolas. He's worked in the newspaper, writing columns, and interviewing musicians for quite some time.
Oh, well, there's lots of them. Probably the one that is always sticks in my mind is Beyonce. Yoko Ono was super funny, George Carlin. So I was a staff writer, a music columnist at the Express News for just under 20 years and wrote for them almost a quarter of a century. So I feel like I can talk music, talk musician, and maybe be the conduit of their stories. You know, because at the end of the day, I'm not here because I'm some expert of everything about music, but I feel like I am an expert at telling stories. And so if I can help communicate what the music exhibit is about and what these artists are about, I think I've done my job.
If you'd like the chance to meet Hector Saldana yourself, you can usually find him here at the Legends of Tejano music exhibit on the 7th floor of Alkek. For Bobcat Update, I'm Matthew Harrington.
Okay, so I might have to visit the 7th floor of Alkek to hear more about Beyonce.
That would be fun. And plus, did you see he was laying down some pretty sweet bass tracks.
Maybe you guys could
jam out. Yeah, that'd be pretty cool.
I don't know about that. Well, that does it for today's Bobcat Update. Thanks for tuning in with us.
Tune in next week for more Bobcat Update. Have a great weekend.